that we may be here with you now, but that intention may go with us as we go about our week. Move us to be your people. Reveal to us how you are calling us to be in this world. Reveal the kingdom to us so that we may help to build it further. In your name we pray. Amen.
As we gather together to celebrate the resurrection of Jesus and the transitions of transformation in our lives, let us follow Jesus' example and give everything we are to God as we join in our call to worship. You who are faithful to the Lord, sing praises to God.
We give thanks to God's holy name.
We exalt you, Lord.
Because you pulled us up.
You brought us up from the grave.
You brought us back to life.
You changed our mourning into dancing. Our whole beings give thanks and sing praises to you now, and we will never stop. In anticipation of experiencing the risen Jesus with us today, let us proclaim the good news of our resurrected Lord and sing "Christ is risen." Shout Hosanna. You are invited to stand if you are able to and move how the Spirit moves you.
Everyone needs compassion, a love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs a Savior, a love that's never failing. Now I surrender. Savior, He can move a mountain. Our God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever, author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. We need that compassion. We need that forgiveness. And God has done that through conquering the grave in Jesus Christ. So let's come before God as we are, knowing that in the conquering of death, we have been given new life and hope eternal. Let us come to God in our prayer confession. God of life, you turn mourning into dancing, the dark night of weeping into the bright morning of gladness. Your light has shined upon us, claiming us as witnesses to your saving power. Yet we keep silent and hide your light. Forgive us when we turn away from your calling and offer meager witness to the glad news of your light breaking into the world in the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus. Empower us by your Holy Spirit to proclaim this gospel to all, and in your grace, accept our personal prayers of confession offered to you. Our God is mighty to save. So friends, believe and proclaim the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. You may be seated as we invite the children to come forward for a time with the children.
I'm an orphan.
Yes,
sir. Sally.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
I need a little
army. Yes, sir. I'm in over Martin LG. I'm in over me. Yes, sir.
I'm in the Lord's army.
Yes, sir.
This was a fail. I agree. I agree truly.
Help.
Blah, 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 blah.
Blah, 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 blah.
Says it was a fail.
Blah, 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 blah.
And let us sing together, Savior, like a shepherd, lead us.
This morning we are here, we hear the word of our Lord in the book of Acts, chapter 9, verses 1 through 20. Meanwhile, Saul, still breathing threats of murder against the disciples of the Lord, went to the high priest and asked him for letters to the synagogues at Damascus, so that if he found any who belonged to the way, men or women, he might bring them bound to Jerusalem. Now, as he was going along and approaching Damascus, suddenly a light from the heaven flashed around him. He fell to the ground and heard a voice saying to him,
Saul, Saul,
Why do you persecute me?
Saul asked.
Who are you, Lord?
The reply came.
I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting. But get up and enter the city, and you will be told what you are to do.
The men who were traveling with him stood speechless because they heard the voice but saw no one. Saul got up from the ground, and though his eyes were open, he could see nothing. So they led him by the hand and brought him into Damascus. For 3 days he was without sight, neither drank or ate. Now there was a disciple in Damascus named Ananias. The Lord said to him in a vision,
Ananias,
he answered,
Here I am, Lord.
The Lord said to him,
Get up and go to the street called Straight, and at the house of Judas look for a man of Tarsus named Saul. At this moment he is praying, and he has seen a vision, a man named Ananias. Come in and lay his hands on him so that he might regain his sight.
But Ananias answered,
Lord, I have heard from many about this man, how much evil he has done to your saints in Jerusalem. And here he has authority from the chief priest to bind all who invoke your name.
But the Lord then said to him,
Go, for he is an instrument who I have chosen to bring my name before Gentiles and kings, and before the people of Israel. I myself will show him how much he must suffer for the sake of my name.
So Ananias went and entered the house. He laid his hands on Saul and said,
Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus, who appeared to you on your way here, has sent me, so that you may regain your sight and be filled with the Holy Spirit.
And immediately something like scales fell from his eyes, and his sight was restored. Then he got up and was baptized, and after taking some food, he regained his strength. For several days he was with the disciples in Damascus, and immediately he began to proclaim Jesus in the synagogues, saying,
He is the Son of God.
This is God's word of hope for God's people. Let us give thanks to God.
Let us hear also the word of God from John's Gospel, chapter 21, the very last chapter in John. Let us listen for the word God has for us today. After these things, Jesus showed himself again to the disciples by the Sea of Tiberias, and he showed himself in this way. Gathered there together were Simon Peter, Thomas, called the twin, Nathanael of Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two others of his disciples. Simon Peter said to them, I'm going to go fishing. They said to him, We will go with you. They went out and got into the boat, but that night they caught nothing. Just after daybreak, Jesus stood on the beach, but the disciples did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to them, Children, you have no fish, have you? They answered him, No. He said to them, Cast the net to the right side of the boat, and you will find some. So they cast it. And now they were not able to haul it in because there was so many fish. That disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, It is the Lord. When Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he put on some clothes, for he was naked, and jumped into the lake. But the other disciples came in the boat, dragging the net full of fish, for they were not far from the land, only about 100 yards off. When they had gone ashore, they saw a charcoal fire there with fish on it and bread. Jesus said to them, Bring some of the fish that you have just caught. So Simon Peter went aboard and hauled the net ashore full of large fish, 153 of them. And though there were so many, the net was not torn. Jesus said to them, Come and have breakfast. Now none of the disciples dared to ask him, Who are you? Because they knew it was the Lord. Jesus came and took the bread and gave it to them and did the same with the fish. This was now the third time that Jesus appeared to the disciples after he was raised from the dead. When they had finished breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" He said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Feed my lambs." A second time he said to him, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" He said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Tend my sheep." He said to him the third time, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" Peter felt hurt because he had said to him the third time, "Do you love me?" And he said to Jesus, "Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Feed my sheep. Very truly, I tell you, when you were younger, you used to fasten your own belt and to go wherever you wished. But when you grow old, you will stretch out your hands, and someone else will fasten a belt around you and take you where you do not wish to go." He said this to indicate the kind of death by which he would glorify God. After this, Jesus said to him, "Follow me." This is God's message for us today, and we say, thank you, God. A long, long time ago, I do get a sermon, that's all right. I know we're all full, so I'll try to keep us engaged. It's okay. Long, long time ago, in a land far, far away, there was a princess named Buttercup. And Princess Buttercup was kidnapped by Vizzini and his motley crew. And well, let's see what actually happens from here.
You gotta plug the sound in.
Despite what you think, you will be caught. And when you are, the prince will see you all hanged.
You sure know about this fellow us?
As I told you, it would be absolutely, totally, and in all other ways, inconceivable. No one in Gilder knows what we've done, and no one in Florin could have gotten here so fast.
He's climbing the rope, and he's gaining on us.
Inconceivable. Faster!
I thought I was going faster. You got very good arms.
He didn't fall? Inconceivable!
You keep using the word. I do not think it means what you think it means.
Inconceivable!
So Vizzini is the leader that you see, and the idea is that they steal this princess in order to start something. But in Vizzini's case, he thinks he's so smart that there are things that are just inconceivable, things that could never happen. A ship catching up to them would be inconceivable. A man who could climb as fast as one of his men, who was played by Andre the Giant, is inconceivable. It seems that there's possibly two things here. Either Vizzini does not understand what the word inconceivable means, as his friend tells him at some point, or Vizzini sees things as inconceivable that are actually not. They're conceivable, they're doable, they're attainable. And we have a God that kind of thinks the same way. Either God doesn't understand what the word inconceivable means, or God laughs at the idea of something being inconceivable and decides to do it anyway. In our passages today, we see that there are a lot of inconceivable things that happen. Peter being chosen to lead the church seemed like a good idea at the time when he was following Jesus. But then we see Peter fall away. Peter denies Jesus three times. Peter actually goes and hides while Jesus is on the cross. After Jesus is resurrected, Peter doesn't really tell anybody. He goes and locks himself in a house. And then Peter does what he normally does, or what he did before. he met Jesus. He goes fishing. Peter has kind of removed himself from that whole discipleship group, just kind of separated himself from Jesus Christ, and yet Jesus comes to him, calls him by name, Simon Peter, do you love me? And Peter says, yes, Lord, you know I love you. Feed my sheep. 3 times they have this conversation, and Peter's hurt by it. But in some ways, Jesus is redeeming Peter for the 3 times that he turned his back on Jesus. For the 3 times that Peter denied Jesus, Jesus then asks 3 more times, do you love me? And allows Peter to say yes for 3 times. Because in the midst of everything else going on, in the midst of him falling away, the one thing that seems to have stayed true for Peter is that he still loves Jesus in the midst of this. But for Jesus to choose Peter, rather than to choose the disciple whom Jesus loved, who was there at the cross and who was there at the empty grave, or Thomas, who's there with him now, and was the only one who wasn't afraid enough to lock himself in a house after the resurrection. Those seem to me good choices, solid choices. But for Peter to be the rock of the church after all he had been through just seems to be
inconceivable. Inconceivable! 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 Inconceivable!
And then we move on later to Paul, or Saul as he's now called. There are plenty of people that God could have chosen to be another apostle, to go out and share the word. But Saul is the exact opposite of what you would expect. Saul, who would later become Paul after his conversion, is a Jewish priest who is killing the followers of Jesus. We heard it in the passage today. Jesus says, why are you killing me? I mean, he's got legal rights to go and kill those who are threatening the Jewish tradition. And they're threatening the Jewish tradition because they're going off. They're leaving the synagogues. They're leaving the temples to follow this Jesus Christ person who had this really crazy way of talking about faith and talking about God. And when he couldn't kill them, he had the authority to go and arrest them. Not the most conceivable person to do this. Paul is like the person that you graduate with that they barely graduated. Now, I'm sure we don't have any of those kids here today. I'm sure we have none of those students. But, you know, there are some that they barely squeak by. And when you're graduating with them, you're like, good luck in the future. Your future seems to be going down a path that may not be the best. But then 5 years later, you meet them again, and they've completely turned 180 degrees, and their life is completely different, and they're really successful. I mean, their life just changed, and that's who Paul is. It's this person who goes from just completely inconceivable as being an apostle of God, of sharing God's word, of growing the church early on, to someone who writes letters that we read in the Bible now, 2,000 years later, to someone who goes and spreads the word. Completely inconceivable. But God said, no, this is going to happen. And then there's Ananias. Ananias makes sense. I mean, let's be honest, he makes sense. He's a faithful follower of Jesus. He's a disciple. He shares the word. And so God says, hey, come and talk to Paul. Come and talk to Saul. And Ananias is like, wait, what? It makes no sense for me to go talk to Paul. Paul is killing people. God, have you not heard this? Have you been on vacation? Is it summertime and I'm just missing it now? Paul even has the authority to arrest those, to bind those up who are following Christ. Why would I go? Why would I go and help this person who could possibly kill me or throw me in jail? It is absolutely
inconceivable. Inconceivable! 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 Inconceivable!
And yet, throughout our passages and throughout history, we see that God does the inconceivable. That what God can conceive, what God can see, what God envisions is oftentimes way far beyond what we can see or what we even understand. The story of Jonah is another one in the Old Testament that we see. Jonah is being sent to Nineveh, which is the empire that is oppressing his people. So God sends Jonah there to tell them to repent or else God's going to destroy them. And Jonah's like, this makes no sense. You're sending me to go save the people who are killing and oppressing your people. And so he runs in the opposite direction. But God brings him back. But God brings him back. But God brings him back in a whale. And Jonah becomes the most successful prophet ever. Jonah walks only a third way into the city, and the whole city converts and starts believing God, according to the story. The whole city. This person who thought that it was inconceivable for this city to be saved, and in fact mourns and cries about it after they're saved, God says, no, this is what we're going to do. You're going to save them because that's who I am. I want to be with my people. And then we see it throughout the scriptures in the Old and New Testament. We see that God, even in the midst of death, that God brings about life, which could only be conceivable by God. The fact that from death would bring new life for not only the dead, but for everyone. And we see it in our very lives. We live in an inconceivable world right now. 30 years ago, it was inconceivable that anyone would even own a personal computer because it was too big. And now a majority of society carries around a personal computer in their pocket every day and can't seem to exist without it. True, thank you. It was inconceivable. It was inconceivable that we would have a Catholic president. But then John F. Kennedy was elected president. It was inconceivable that we would have a minority president, but then Barack Obama was elected president. It was inconceivable for a woman to be president. And while a woman has not become president yet, the open idea of a woman being president seems to be opening more and more. It was inconceivable. Even in our church today, even in the midst of Christianity, we're living out things that were not conceived. We are a church now that 50 years ago would not have been expected at all. Look around on a Sunday morning and the sanctuaries are no longer full. That was not expected 50 years ago. In the midst of that, the largest growing area of faith in the United States are those who are atheists, agnostics, and those who claim to be spiritual but not religious. Every other Christian area is shrinking. Inconceivable. But in the midst of this, we are also experiencing things that were inconceivable. 50 years ago, it was inconceivable that women would be leaders in church. And not only are they leaders, but now in many denominations, including our own, they're able to be ordained and be pastors. They're able to lead a church. It was inconceivable that you could miss a Sunday and yet still see it and hear it and experience that worship service. Or if you were tired, you could just watch church in your pajamas. But we can do that now. And it was inconceivable that all this would happen. And yet that's what God does. God does the inconceivable. God does the things that we can't see, but God can. And God calls us to be the apostles, to be the ones sending out the word of God, to share the word of God in ways that we cannot fathom, but in ways that God can see and envision for us. It is inconceivable that a group of eighth graders would stand up and make a statement against their denomination's practice. Did anyone hear this story this week? Eighth graders at a United Methodist Church in Omaha went through a whole year of confirmation and they decided not to join the church as a group. They didn't join the church because they didn't agree with what their denomination had chosen in an international conference they had a few months back, about gay priests or gay pastors, and then also the place of LGBTQ weddings in the church. They didn't agree. And they said that if they were to join the church, they feel like they would be showing their approval for the direction that the denomination is going. And yet, eight middle schoolers wrote a letter and then stood up on Confirmation Sunday and said, "We are not ready to join yet." Whether we agree with the stance that they took, the reason they took the stance or not, whether we agree with what the denomination said or not, the idea that eighth graders, probably with the support of their family, would be able to stand up and say, "We, as the present of members of the church, are not okay with where this is going. We feel like this is not where God is calling us to go." That is inconceivable. And yet it happened. And we are called to do the inconceivable in the midst of this chaotic time. We are called to be the apostles that go out and share God's love, just like we talked about last week, that we are sent out as apostles to be Christ's body, hands and feet, to be the body of Christ in the world, to do the inconceivable. Our graduates have a whole life of achieving the inconceivable before them. Most of the things you won't even see. You won't be able to see it coming, but God will use you to do things that we could have never predicted. And we, as their church family, we live out that calling as well, as individuals and as the church, to be God's apostles, to be God's presence, to achieve the inconceivable. And in the midst of this changing world, that is what we're going to have to do. To see the kingdom grow, to see the body of Christ become whole, we're going to have to trust God to do things that we can't even foresee now, but somewhere down the road we're going to have the opportunity to do. We are going to be able to follow Paul and have the scales taken off of our eyes so that we can see God in this world in a new way. We are going to have the opportunity to be Peter, to show that we love Jesus Christ by feeding and caring for his flock. And we're going to be like Ananias, reaching out to those that we would have never suspected that we would have reached out to before. Because we have a God that nothing is inconceivable for. What is inconceivable in our eyes is the vision of God in the future. We are all graduates. We're all at a place where we're taking new steps forward and maybe not knowing what it's going to look like. And yet, we have a God who goes with us. A God who goes with us that can see further than we can see, that knows more than we know, but decides to walk even each and every step with us in this midst. We have a God who sees the inconceivable as something to be attained, as something that is doable. And so we're called. We are called to think anew, called to use our imaginations, to lead with energy, imagination, hope, and faith, to be the people that God created us to be, to create the kingdom outside of the walls of this church. And we can do that. We can do that. No matter who we are, no matter what we've done or left undone, no matter the past, because we are redeemed by the God that we celebrate as risen from the dead. The God that gives us hope, the God that gives us life. The God that does
inconceivable
things in our lives and in this world. So let us follow God into the inconceivable and achieve it. And may all God's children say together, amen.
As Jesus, God gave us everything we ever needed, the freedom of new life and hope. God continues to provide for us and use us to provide for others in need. With thankful and faithful hearts, let us give our tithes, offerings, and our lives to God.
the earth shall soon dissolve like snow. The sun forbear to shine. But God, who called me here below, will be forever mine. Will be forever.
Almighty God, through your only Son, you overcame death and opened to the gates of everlasting life. Grant that we who celebrate our Lord's resurrection may, through the renewing power of your Spirit, arise from the death of sin to the life of righteousness, and may use your gift of new life to be blessings to others and share your new life with the world. In your name we lift our praise and offerings to you. Amen.
And it is obviously not inconceivable that we skipped part of the service. So we will, if you're invited to be seated, we'll do prayers of intercession, and then we'll do the final hymn. So having given our gifts to God, let us now lift up our prayers to God. Let's pray. Gracious God, we thank you that you are a forgiving God when we forget to do things. We thank you, Lord, that you are a God of order and of chaos. So if things are not in order, you still hear us and are with us. Lord, we come to you this morning with excitement. Excitement for the future of those who are with us, for everyone, but in particular Wyatt and Ainsley and Allison and Mercedes, for the future that you have planned for them, and for the future that you have planned for us. But that future does bring worry and concern and anxiety of the unknown and what you have out there for us. And so we thank you for walking each step with us. Thank you that when we cannot see, you help us to see anew. That you help us to reach out to those that we feel uncomfortable around. We thank you that you forgive us and give us second and third and fourth and infinity chances to be who you created us to be. God, we thank you for the little feet around this building. We thank you for the meal that was shared this morning and for the meals that will be shared amongst our family of Christ the rest of this week. God, we thank you for the beautiful weather. We thank you for the hope that comes with the empty tomb. We thank you for your faith that is steadfast even when ours is wavering. Gracious God, in the midst of our thankfulness, we have concerns and worries as well. So we pray for those who continue to be persecuted for their faith, no matter what that faith is. We pray for the churches that have been bombed and that have been attacked. We pray for those who are suffering mentally, spiritually, emotionally, physically, for those who find it hard each and every day just to get out of bed. Lord, we lift up those that we have promised to pray for. And for those who have no one to pray for them, we lift them up to you now. Lord, we lift up those in our church family. For Carol and Diane, Verna and Willard, Bob and Dorothy, Phyllis, Charlotte, Dorothy, Dennis, William, Jean, and Barb. For those in our community who don't know where their next meal is coming from, for those who are struggling with addiction, for those who don't have shelter, Lord, we pray that you would help us to be your hands and feet, to help them however we are able. Help us to build the kingdom, your kingdom, upon this earth. Lord, we thank you. We lift up all these prayers to you that have been spoken aloud and that are shouting in our souls or in our minds. For we know that you hear them even without us speaking them aloud. Lord, gracious God, we entrust all of our concerns to you. Lord, we commend to your care our souls and our bodies, our minds and our thoughts, our health and our work, our parents, our children, our families, our neighbors and friends, our life and our death. We place them all in your hands this day and always. And with thanksgiving and praise for all that you have done, we pray to you as your Son taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And now let us sing together, Let us talents and tongues employ. Rise as you are able. We celebrate our seniors and congratulate them one last time. And now, along with our graduating seniors, let us go out and follow God in achieving the inconceivable, being the hands and feet of Christ in the world, sharing God's love and making Christ known. And let us commit our lives to the Lord Jesus Christ. Christ in my beginning, Christ there at my end, Christ be in my journey, Christ everlasting friend, Christ be in my waking, Christ at my repose, Christ in every action, Christ when eyelids close. And as we go out, may the Lord bless us and keep us. The Lord make his face to shine upon us and be gracious unto us. The Lord lift up his countenance unto us and grant us peace. The Lord's name is upon us. We are blessed. And may all God's children say together, Amen.